the first time I've presented on this topic, and so if there's anything with unclear definitions that you'd like to know, just interrupt me and I'll answer. Okay, so what I'll be talking about today is really a conceptual framework and initial evidence for how the role of public health in potentially mitigating food programming effects. Okay, so this presentation is based on a paper that we recently published. So I'd like to not only recognize my co-authors, but really kind of illustrate the interdisciplinary nature of the research team. This is a really exciting area that's at the intersection of at least three or four different fields. So I just had a nice introduction. I'm an obesity epidemiologist, really focused on diet because of activity. Lynn Messer, I work with her quite closely. She brings expertise in a really complementary set of exposures. She looks at social exposures, environmental, the sort of chemical variety, and she's a reproductive epidemiologist. Steve Fortman is a cardiovascular epidemiologist. Larry Wallach is an expert in public health policy and communication, and he's doing a lot of work in how to communicate aspects of global origins without stigmatizing or blaming individuals or groups of people. And Kent Thornburg is a physiologist. He's a real leader in fetal programming physiology. So we've all worked together on these concepts, and I'm really happy to hear what you think about them. Okay, so I'll begin with talking about this conceptual framework. I'm sure you've all heard of developmental origins of disease by now, fetal programming. Just to define my terms, I will also describe what I mean by that. So essentially, we have, in this case, an obese mother, intrauterine exposures could be really anything, chemical pollutants, stress, undernutrition was really where the field started. And so we have a growing understanding of how these intrauterine exposures can impact fetal development in a way that places the child at increased risk throughout their lifespan. And so we're kind of symbolizing these changes with this red star. Okay, so in the context of maternal obesity, what we have here is a potential cycle. So we have a mother who is obese, transmitting risk to her child, who's going to grow, become the next generation of parents, and sort of propagating this cycle. And so naturally, we've become increasingly concerned about how to stop this. So in terms of prevention, the primary focus of prevention efforts is in this area. So focusing on the mother, promoting preconception weight loss, promoting healthy gestational weight gain. And what these are doing are they're trying to prevent fetal programming from occurring. And this is, we should be doing this. This is absolutely necessary. But if we consider over the past decade or so, about 20% of children were born to mothers who are obese. This is even higher in vulnerable subgroups, 29% of African Americans. And we could argue that even if we had 100% effective prenatal interventions, maybe we would probably not reach all women, especially in these really vulnerable subgroups. So the question is, what do we do about these children? They're really high risk. What can be done to prevent obesity and disease later in a child's life? And specifically, how and when can we prevent the manifestation of fetal programming effects? So I'll talk a little bit more about this and some initial evidence throughout this talk. So when I started thinking about this question, so what can public health do after pregnancy is all lost once the baby is born? I came to realize, okay, we need to dig a little deeper. We need to reference the animal literature that's produced so much of our knowledge about the mechanisms behind this. So, you know, thinking about what changes need to be reversed or overcome, and you know, what's encompassed in this red star. These mechanisms are still being worked out. It's a vibrant area of research. I'll just talk about a few examples of things that we have pretty good evidence for. So at the time of birth, infants born to mothers who are obese, they tend to have more fat, and they can be insulin resistant even as early as birth. Throughout their life, there's changes to a variety of body systems. There's changes in the brain that alters the ability to regulate appetite. Skeletal muscle, I'm sure you know the importance of skeletal muscle in glucose metabolism. If you lower skeletal muscle mass, alter glucose regulation, alterations to the liver, which alters lipid metabolism. And all of these pieces are what places the offspring at increased risk of obesity, diabetes, fatty liver, and cardiovascular disease. Okay, so if we think about these specific biologic changes, you know, we can guess that these children would be less resilient to poor diet and sedentary lifestyle, that they would really sort of attack studies that actually examine effects of first hits followed by second hits. We looked at the animal literature and the human literature, focusing on maternal obesity, first hit, and followed by either a dietary or a physical activity second hit. And what we found is the bulk of the evidence, overwhelmingly, is in the animal literature. Most of the evidence is in rodents, and as you can imagine, rodents have very short life cycles, so we can look at these multi-generational effects easily, and you can easily manipulate their first and their second exposures. Okay, so that's why I'm showing a mouse instead of a person. So I wanted to, the basic experimental design used in these studies, there were slight variations, just in part to kind of show you what the evidence is, but also to emphasize, or re-emphasize what I mean by first and second hits. So here we have two female mice. This is the SO's generation. One is fed a high-fat diet, one's fed a healthy diet. And in the animal studies, maternal obesity is typically induced with high-fat diet feeding. Okay, so then the females have babies. So the red babies are, you can think of those as the red stars. The green babies don't have the fetal program. And then the offspring undergo the same treatments, okay? And so we have sort of a four groups that we can compare: the double hit group in bright red, and then kind of this no hit group in dark green. Okay, so I'll just show you a few example findings just to give you a flavor of what is known. So this is a high-fat diet first hit followed by a high-fat diet second hit study. It's showing insulin resistance shown across these same four groups. So the most obvious finding here is that this double hit group is the most insulin resistant, and that's what you would expect. There's two other things I want to point out. The first is that there was minimal effect of maternal high-fat diet if the offspring was fed a healthy post-communion diet. So, in other words, so this is the no-hit group. They're the least insulin resistant. But here is the group who were born to the obese mom, but they ate a healthy diet after weaning. Okay, and they have equivalent insulin. And so what I would term this complete mitigation. This is actually uncommon. This is a pretty remarkable finding. I would say maybe 5 to 10% of the study showed this pronounced finding. Most of them showed partial mitigation, where instead of 0.95, this would be, lower than the double hit group, but it's more in the middle. And the second thing you can notice is that the effect of post-beginning high-fat diet much stronger in rats born to high fat diet fed mothers. Okay, so what do I mean by that? So if we're simply looking at the effect of high fat diet post weaning in the offspring. Okay, so here we're seeing about a sevenfold difference in the offspring of the high fat diet fed mothers. Among the offspring of the control mother, we're seeing less than a fivefold. So what this is suggesting is that you're seeing sort of exacerbated effects of high-fat diet in the offspring if they have a first hit. And this is really very typical of what we saw for ALEC, and it's typical of what we see with maternal undernutrition models as well.
It's interesting because it's like that. Because we don't, it's that.
Mr. Lepton, you would expect food suppression or food intake to go down, as what Lepton is supposed to do. And what we see is that that occurs in all four groups, or all of these three groups, so all groups except for the double hit group, and that they're showing really no response to leptin. And so we can interpret this as maternal high fat diet induced leptin resistance, which is, indicates dysregulation of satiety. This is one of the mechanisms that's thought to promote obesity. Okay, so then in terms of the mitigation question, post-weaning exercise, this group rescued the maternal high fat diet induced leptin resistance. And so they basically looked equivalent to the offspring of the control mothers. Okay, so this is another example of complete mitigation, which again is rare, but it's plausible. Okay. And the second point, again, I'm going to keep saying this, but this idea of heterogeneous effects that are dependent on prenatal condition. Okay, so if we're interested, if we're looking at the effects of exercise on leptin response, if we were only looking at the offspring of the obese moth, this is a really dramatic effect. And if we're only looking at the offspring of the child-fed mothers, we're seeing no effect at all. Okay, so again, exacerbated effects in offspring with the first hit. Okay, so I won't go into these in details. I just wanted to show sort of the variety of research that's out there. So this is not diet or physical activity, but there's a small number of studies that look at air pollution, first hits and second hits, sort of mixed findings. But there's some evidence that, as you would expect, prenatal exposure, in this case to diesel exhaust, kind of prime the offspring for exaggerated effects of ozone on airway nitrogen reactivity, on vesicles, and relevant for asthma. Okay, there's some psychosocial stress models as well. So the mothers were underwent immobilization stress, which is one model of stress in animals. Same for the offspring. And again, there's sort of a hyper response to stress on offspring. Okay, so I just spent a whole lot of time talking about animals. I'm not an animal researcher, but I really value that evidence because it provides a nice sort of biologic foundation to build the human evidence. So I'll talk a little bit about humans. There's a series of experimental studies. This was done in a cohort of Danish men. And they underwent a series of challenges, not all at the same time in separate studies, but they did a high fat overfeeding study for 5 days, an activity study, so this was bed rest for 9 days, and an exercise for 12 weeks. And what they did is they compared the physiologic response to these challenges between low birth weight and normal birth weight. And really across the board, they're seeing differences that are consistent with the animal studies, where they're seeing stronger response in the low birth weight men. Okay, so in humans, what we're usually, at least traditionally, kind of struck with is this birth weight as a proxy for fetal development. I'll talk about the limitations of that, but that's what we have here. Okay, so and there's also a small body of observational research as well in epidemiology. This is a study that we did in NHANES. So these are adolescent girls. So what you have here is their BMI Z-score on the y-axis, moderate to vigorous physical activity on the x-axis. And we're showing this relationship by birth weight. So the black line is normal birth weight, the blue line is low birth weight. epidemiology, that's actually not atypical to see a flat line because of activity due to a variety of reasons, but that's not atypical. But we're seeing, you know, a really clear relationship in hyperthermic vehicles. Okay, so this is a cross-sectional study. This is a longitudinal study using National Longitudinal Study of Adolescent Health. Again, I'm pulling out the females because they keep most of these studies are gender stratified, and almost always the girls are really popping out and showing the biggest differences. And I really apologize, I know you can't read this all. I will explain what this is. So this is CVD risk score on the y-axis, weekly frequency of physical activity, and this is physical activity at wave one when they were adolescents, and the CVD risk was when they were in their 30s or so. And so it's set up the same way, same colored lines, and so we're seeing, you know, sort of flattish lines for low and normal work weight, and then a really pronounced association for high work weight. So again, this is the high work weight girls that are sort of popping out as being showing these interactions. And I'll pause for those questions, comments, complaints. No? Okay. So this is my last MD study that I'll show. So this is asking a slightly different question. So far we're talking about diet and physical activity as second hits. This is treating BMI actually as a second hit. So they're asking the question, you know, what if we could just prevent obesity, if we could control weight gain in these kids, can we prevent them from developing diabetes? So this is another study in health, again in females. And so what this is showing, so this is birth weight now on the x-axis, and then probability of either prediabetes or diabetes on the y-axis. And these are adjusted for all of the typical things that you adjust for. So this is the trajectory that is not adjusted for the BMI trajectory. Okay, so this is showing, you know, that at higher birth weight, they're slightly lower, but not significantly. So risk of or diabetes by angle. Okay, this orange line is adjusted for BMI. So of course, when we're doing epidemiology, controlling for things, we need to think about what those adjusted associations mean. So what this orange line reflects is the relationship between birth weight and diabetes that does not operate through BMI. Okay? And so this sort of is in contrast to the way that we normally think about diabetes, where, you know, first comes obesity and then comes diabetes. But, you know, if we insert some of these fetal programming effects, you know, being born with insulin resistance, you know, BMI is potentially not played as big a role. Okay, so we're seeing this very pronounced relationship, higher birth weight, higher risk of diabetes, that is not explained by BMI. Okay, so what I take away from this is that it suggests that mitigation of birth weight associated diabetes risk requires intervention on factors other than obesity. Okay, so if we're focusing on obesity, and I'm an obesity researcher, and so this is quite a little shift for me, but you know, maybe we need to be tackling the other vulnerabilities that are separate. As many pancreatic beta cells, so you're bringing them out faster. So So there are these sort of physiologic differences that that aren't impacted by the live inputs that may increase risk.
Yeah. Also, are you looking at then exercise separately because of its effect on insulin resistance?
Yes.
Apart from.
Yeah, and that's why I'm generally interested in physical activity, but that's why I'm so excited about it, because it is, it could sort of be a backdoor to helping them. Exactly. And so, you know, and I think that related studies to really dig into this, it requires more than epidemiology. It requires some of these other types of physiologic studies that I showed. And, you know, again, kind of emphasizing this interdisciplinary research area. So, we, you know, there's all sorts of that. Okay, so I'm just going to, I'll run through this pretty quickly. I want to be able to discuss. Basically, what this slide says is that the human research, human evidence is really very weak. So all the studies that I show, there's been a handful of other similar epi studies in different study populations showing similar things. We're all relying on birth weight as a proxy. So better ways to do this would be to look at maternal measures, which of course requires, you know, linked databases, or measures that more directly measure fetal programming. So placental measures, biomarkers that don't exist yet, but they're on their way. And then really just continuing to do this kind of work, characterizing what types of behavioral targets are needed, defining the doses that would be needed, when should we be intervening. And then lastly, Kate mentioned that my history included neighborhood environment research. You know, that there's no, you know, I think that we could hypothesize that children with fetal programming interventions might be really hyper-responsive to a lot of the food marketing, the food cues that we see, but that work hasn't been done. So I think that's a really exciting area. Okay. So what does this mean for public health? What are we talking about? Okay, so let's revisit these considerations for public health. I'm actually going to ask you what you think. So the first one, so to what extent can public health approaches mitigate the effects of adverse prenatal conditions? What do you think? No one answers that. So what do you think about after the child's born and they're growing up? Is there, based on this evidence, do you think that we can help them? Should we take a vote? I'm really interested, actually, in what you think. So do you think we can help them? Yes? Okay.
Yay!
No? Okay. You know, you can like email me afterwards if you.
Yeah.
showed up and it's for diet and selectivity because that's what we look for. And there's some in other areas. We can also think about, you know, looking beyond.
I think sometimes we don't always like get there in time in terms of like preventing obesity, and maybe with these kids, like getting to them earlier with the physical activity and like limiting fat in the diet.
So you're thinking that this is suggesting, like, you know, supporting earlier intervention.
Yeah.
I think too, like, it's hard to distinguish sometimes between like the first hits and second hits. Like, a lot of public deals with the overall picture without targeting necessarily specific groups. And I think like maybe working on that would be good, because, you know, saying like you should eat a healthy diet could, you know, affect the mom and also the children. So maybe making the prevention aspect more specific.
I think maybe acknowledging the first hits and the predisposition moves us away from a framework where we can sound like we are blaming children for their what's the preferred predisposition.
Yeah.
Just even acknowledging that we're working on a second hit situation, you know, it opens up the space, but that there is in fact diversity in how people respond. There's diversity in where your trajectory would have gone with no intervention.
Yeah.
And so if we're, you know, delaying something versus preventing it, we're still potentially mitigating something, but also that it will be more difficult for some kids than others.
Yeah, I love that. Thanks. Okay, and so I like what you said about, so maybe if this child is staying that's actually a success. And then also, you know, issues of sort of heightened susceptibility and hyper-responsibility as well. Okay. How much do I have time?
1:45.
Okay. So I have time for my crazy graph. So this is to insert kind of a health disparities perspective, and I imagine a lot of these ideas started to sort of roll around in the brain when I was talking. So I'll take a few minutes to explain this. On the y-axis, this is showing health risk. This is just a theoretical model. It's with better health risk is higher. Okay, and then we have health risk across three generations, so 1, 2, 3. Okay, so if we think about sort of the advantage lineage, so, you know, a family who have always had the resources they need to live a healthy life, you know, they're going to have a good health status. There's not going to be much of this programming you know, to pass on to the next generation, and they're going to be pretty happy. If one of these individuals encounters an exposure, you know, they could experience a drop in health status and maybe, you know, stay with them for their life, and then potentially get passed on to the next generation. So if we think about a more disadvantaged trajectory, and so this is, you know, this is intergenerational poverty. So they're going to start out low because of their history, pass on risk to their to the next generation. They might encounter these exposures, but they might experience an even stronger drop in health status due to the same exposure than they were engaged in. Okay, and then, you know, then they move on and they reproduce and they this health status continue to drop in the generations. So again, this is just theoretical. It's just a way to kind of bring some of this together and think about the role of developmental organs of disease in intergenerational disparities. And I think when we think about disparities, we typically think of differential exposures. And so, you know, that this disadvantaged group is they just have more exposure to bad things. And what we're suggesting here is, yes, that's true, but they also might experience a greater impact on our health through the same exposure. So, you know, this of course needs to be tested, but it's hopefully a useful way of thinking. Any thoughts or questions? So depressed. partnerships, we can public health and preventive medicine, we can really implement sort of personalized prevention approaches might be needed. Okay, and then I just want to touch on a couple specific things that that need are in need of more research. So building on this idea of these brain alterations, that the kids aren't able to regulate their appetite as well, key knowledge gaps, other what kinds of eating behaviors, and we're thinking about doing some work with that, are altered, what can we target, and sensitivity to environmental drivers, how can we change the environment so that you're not constantly being cued to eat unhealthy foods. The skeletal muscle question, I touched on this, or we recommend different types or doses of physical activity. Are there certain dietary targets? Maybe I would guess sugar-sweetened beverages would be really terrible for a kid who can't regulate their glucose very well. Okay. And so I just touched on, we talked about some animal research, we talked about some human physiology research, we talked about epidemiology. That's just beginning. There's been, as far as I know, not much behavioral research. I've seen a single behavioral intervention that contrasted by prenatal condition. And so all of that would be valuable to know. And the end goal here is to drive public health policy to address intergenerational obesity. So I mentioned Larry Wallach, his colleague Leanna Manette, they're experts in public health communication, and they're developing a lot of ideas and guidelines for how can we communicate these concepts, and we'll need to do this to the lay public and policymakers, without blaming mothers, without blaming entire communities, which it could be interpreted that way, without stigmatizing groups. I think it's also another exciting aspect of this, that it's just, it brings the full spectrum of public health and how to make all of this work. Okay, so just to quickly acknowledge the Oregon Birch, this award really supported me delving into this this content area and continuing to work on it with the KO1. There's so few epi studies that are starting to do this, but I think, I would imagine that people see that.
Have there been any studies that look at breastfeeding after mothers that are obese give birth?
Yeah, so breastfeeding is a big topic. And I, So, you know, I think, so lactation is, breastfeeding is definitely important. There's a big body of literature out there. It, it's protective in many ways. In this context, you know, I think that it, at that point, it's still sort of mother and child together, and, you know, so I kind of group that into sort of early life. But I mean, that's it, that's a really important area. And in the experimental studies, lactation is actually a really important period where basically in most of the studies, the moms who have had that diet through pregnancy and lactation, and if they switch to a normal diet during lactation, the effects are much less.
In
so it's a really important period.